feet. Red light, green light, let my pulse away from me. I tried to break the window and I fell down to my knees. Back up, turn around, coming back for more. I do believe he's taking off full speed and locked the door. Lord.
Full-blown empire across the web, on Fight Now TV, and on radio stations around the world. It's the only daily boxing talk radio show on the planet, hosted by the only guy with the balls to do it. Many have stepped into the ring. Many have tried to take the belt. And one by one, they've fallen.
All right.
Another victim of the undisputed heavyweight champion of Boxing Talk Radio. Talkin' Boxing with Billy C is on now.
My style is impetuous, my defense is impregnable, and I'm just ferocious. I want your heart.
And we're coming to you live from the LDL studio in Coral Springs, Florida. I'm Bill Calogero, and it's time for Billy C's Mayweather-Alvarez Fight Week special. Glad you could join us. This show is being brought to you in part by the TKO Network. Check them out on their website, www.tkonetwork.com. Follow them on Twitter, at the TKO Network, or friend them on Facebook, man. The TKO Network. This show is also being brought to you in part by Sal's Pizzeria. Don't forget about my man Sal Sinicola. He'll be joining us on Saturday when we go to the next person that's bringing, or group, I should say, that's bringing the show to you. Miller's Coral Springs Ale House. It's located on 1915 North University Drive. That's in Coral Springs, Florida. We're going to be broadcasting live Saturday from 8 to about 1:30 a.m., I'm thinking. $10 gets you in the door, and there's drink specials. We'll talk about that all later on the show. And finally, this show is being brought to you in part by my man Ian Grumeza and his new book, The Gentleman Boxer. You got to get a copy of that. Visit our website, www.BillyCBoxing.com, to check that out. And by the way, don't forget to grab yourself a titty. Visit Titty Grab, www.tittygrab.com. Listen, coming up in a little bit, we got some emails we're going to read. We got some of the latest news from the final press conference that took place between Mayweather and Saul Alvarez. But first, joining us right now to kick off the show, my man Dax Khan's with us. What's up, brother?
Hey, what's going on, everybody? Well, busy week.
I come down to get the sun and fun here in Florida. It's been raining. You remember that? You know, here I am at, what is it? Hello, mother. Hello, father. You remember that? Here I am at Camp Granada. They say we will have some fun when it stops raining. Anyway, that's
you
what's
didn't
happening.
Miss anything because she's seen a storm up here last night. So.
I heard. I lost power and everything else up there. But anyway. Listen, we're not going to be doing our normal stuff. We've been beating this fight to death for the last couple of weeks. Let me get your thoughts on it right off the bat, Dax. Floyd Mayweather Jr., he's been talking a lot of smack over the last few days and through this whole promotion. Canelo seems very calm, cool, and collective. I'm wondering if I'm going to change my pick tomorrow. I'm actually, you're the first one to hear this, but I'm actually starting to think twice about how confident I am that Floyd is going to win this fight. What's your thoughts on that, and who do you think is going to win?
You know, I still want to go with Floyd, obviously, because Floyd. But, you know, you're not the only one whose pick's changing. If you look through social media, a lot of people are starting to change their mind, and a lot of people are starting to quote exactly what you were saying last week, that, you know, the fix just might possibly be in.
Yeah, you know, and the thing is more and more people are talking to us about that. John here at LDL and I were talking about that today, how many people are saying that. And we were the first to start talking about that. It was about 2 weeks ago when we started saying about the money involved. And you know, when you start looking at what that rematch would bring, we were talking about it today, this morning, and it's like, think about it, man. I mean, who wouldn't, if anybody decides that this fight's not going to be competitive and they don't buy it or something like that, you know damn sure they're going to get the rematch.
Yeah, and we spoke on the last time we spoke on the air about it, like I said, you know, it's, yeah, sure, it's going to be lucrative. It'll be great money, tremendous money, all-time, you know, highest paydays for both men, probably in the history of the sport. You know, I agree, but, you know, overall, I still am not going to change what I said that day, that, you know, it'll be detrimental, horrible for the sport of boxing. It'll set boxing back 25 years, and to get rid of that surgence that we're going through right now, you know, that resurrection. So, you know, I just hope not. That's all I can say about it.
I actually, as much as I want to see Floyd lose, I certainly wouldn't want to see him get robbed. I've said that for a couple of weeks now. You know, if he wins the fight fair and square, he deserves to get the credit. But does he have a chance at losing? I mean, I know you're picking Floyd, but are you giving Alvarez any kind of a chance?
Sure. You know, to be honest with you, in my opinion, it all depends on Alvarez's chin. You know, how much can Alvarez take it? Floyd Mayweather has not scored a legitimate knockout against, you know, a high, high quality fighter, you know, who can really take it on the chin in years. You know, so if Canelo, his conditioning is, you know, at peak, if he's able to come forward, if his defense has improved from the Austin Trout fight, which, you know, it improved in the Austin Trout fight from his previous fight, and he just keeps coming forward, there's definitely a chance. He's bigger, he's younger, he's strong, he can take it to the body all night long, and, you know, what goes through my head is kind of thinking of a scenario, not exactly, but similar to, you know, Julio Cesar Chavez versus Mildred Taylor, you know, something that if Canelo just applies that pressure all night long, you know, he might wear up the 37-year-old, 36-year-old Floyd Mayweather, and, you know, score something late. Anything can happen, you know. It's not uncalled. It's not, you know, it's not a ludicrous thought to think that, you know, Canelo can win this fight.
You know, a lot of talk, Dax, is questioning Canelo's ability to be around and still be dangerous in the later rounds. What do you think about that?
I think Canelo is more dangerous as the fight goes on. I was thinking about the other day, you know, some of his earlier fights where, you know, he was getting tagged in the beginning and he looked really bad. Then come around, you know, the fourth, fifth, and sixth round, he started turning it up. One fight that I really thought we were going to see the exposure of Canelo was when he fought Alfonso Gomez. Remember those first couple rounds, Alfonso Gomez was catching Canelo fairly easily with that right hand. Canelo was actually going backwards. And then coming third round, you know, Canelo just stepped it up, he changed gears, and he put an end to it. Of course, we all know Alfonso Gomez is nowhere in the league of Floyd Mayweather. But, you know, my point on that is that, you know, he doesn't seem like a guy that gets tired early. He didn't get tired in the Austin Trout fight. He got stronger.
Yeah, but he took rounds off in that fight. You know, there was a couple of rounds where he didn't do much, and all of a sudden he would come back really strong, and that was, you know, people equate that to him, you know, preserving energy, getting it back or whatever. You know, another thing that I noticed, I wanted to get your thoughts about, was that, you know, obviously both fighters have been interviewed 100 million times over the last couple of days, and one of the last interviews that Canelo gave, he actually said what his game plan was, and what they felt were a lot of mistakes that other opponents made when fighting Floyd, and he actually echoed some of the things that we've said about Cotto and Cotto, you know, having the right game plan but starting to go head hunting and all of that. And Canelo said that he is going to work the body, he is going to go after the body for the first five or six rounds, and then you know, go after the head of Floyd. And they relayed that back to Floyd. And, you know, my question to you is this. We know Floyd is assuming that they're going to try to go to the body and everything else. But do you think it was smart for Canelo and Team Canelo to say that and kind of, you know, just give Floyd another heads up? I mean, you know, if I'm fighting Floyd Mayweather, I want every advantage I could possibly get, considering I had to give up all of the, you know, everything's in his favor to begin with.
You know, and what I'm about to say is speculation, of course. Canelo is surrounded by a bunch of people who are no idiots. You know, these aren't, you know, guys who haven't been around the sport a long time. So for all we know, they're trying to be Floyd in his own game. You know, they may be saying that's what they're going to do, and their whole game plan is, you know, the exact opposite. We don't know. It's, you know, it is not, this fight is not definitely in the bag for Floyd. You know, I'm going to pick Floyd, but, you know, as far as, real quick, like you were saying about Canelo taking rounds off, remember something, Floyd Mayweather doesn't fight a fast-paced fight, which can play into Canelo's hands. Floyd Mayweather isn't out there throwing 100 punches a round. Floyd Mayweather likes to lay back and counterpunch, and that may just, you know, fall right into Canelo's hands, you know, if we're talking in terms of his stamina. You know, I don't think we know what the type of fight that Floyd likes, you know, to conduct and the type of pace that he likes to keep. I don't really think it's one that will wear Canelo out. I don't think I've ever seen Floyd Mayweather wear anybody out stamina-wise.
Yeah, maybe not physically, but he'll have a tendency to be able to wear Canelo out mentally, frustration-wise and everything else.
And we don't know. You know what I mean? You know, he's a young kid. You know, if he is very determined. We remember what it was like when we were young. You know, when you're 18, 19, 20, 25, even 30 years old, you'd be surprised what you can do. And you know, never know what Canelo. I mean, you know, if this kid is in there and this kid is saying to himself, you know what, I'm going to go in there and no matter what, I'm going to take it on the chin and I'm going to give it my all. I'm not laying down. And if Floyd Mayweather is not giving him anything that will make him back off, if Floyd Mayweather has no power to keep Canelo in check, that's not good news for Floyd Mayweather, is it?
No. One other thing I want to ask you about this, and then I want to talk a little about the co-main. Is that, you know, Floyd's game with all of this PR and the press conferences and the tours and everything, traditionally, you know, he plays his little gangster role and, you know, he tries to psych out his opponents. He, you know, he's invincible. He can't be beat. Nobody's got the heart of him. We hear it all the time. And throughout all of this, Dax, I noticed something, and I noticed it even more yesterday, is that Canelo... it's calm, cool, and collective. He's not getting rattled. Is that rattling Floyd because he's not getting to this kid?
That could be. You know, kind of like back in school, you know, whether it be junior high school, elementary school, high school, you know, you always had that one kid in the class that got off on pushing everybody's buttons. And the worst thing you could do to that kid was ignore him. And, you know, Floyd Mayweather could be that, you know, that could be happening to Floyd Mayweather. Because Floyd, let's be real, he acts like a big kid, you know, with some of his antics. So that could be bothering Floyd. You know, he could be saying to himself, why am I not getting under this kid's skin when I should be, when I've gotten under the La Hoyas, when I've gotten under Guerreros, and the list goes on. Why is this kid so relaxed? And he may be second-guessing himself, saying, you know, hey, listen, what's this kid know that I don't?
Right.
And again, that's just speculation. You never can tell. You never know.
To fight it at night, at least what I'm thinking now, I hope it is the main event, but it's going to be most likely the Danny Garcia against Lucas Mathysse fight. And I think I'm not going to give out my pick now, but I finally got one. It took me until this morning to finally make a pick in that fight. I think it's extremely hard. I mean, you know, we all know Mathysse's got the power and everything, but Danny's a quality fighter. What's your thoughts on the fight, and who do you see winning?
As I said the other day, I really think Lucas Mathysse is going to knock him out. He's going to knock him out in a big way. It's not that it's not going to be competitive, but Lucas Mathysse, as we talk about, somebody who's always calm, cool, and collective, you know, there's a guy who never gets rattled inside the ring. Danny Garcia doesn't have the power to hurt him, and if anything, just as we were talking about with Floyd, I think that's going to play into the head of Danny Garcia, and especially Danny Garcia has not an angel on his shoulder, but a devil on his shoulder in the corner with Angel Garcia, who I think Angel would be the one to unravel in the corner, and when Angel starts to unravel, he's going to make Danny unravel, which is going to make it even a harder night for Danny. So I'm going with Lucas. My pick hasn't changed on that, and I think Lucas is going to stop him somewhere between the 8th and 10th round.
You know, Dax, the other, when we started this Fight Week special, we had matchmaker Eric Botcher on, and, you know, I asked him a similar question, and he made an interesting answer. And, you know, he really got me thinking, you know, Angel Garcia has the reputation, and at least we all look at him as being a loose cannon, and we've seen his antics at press conferences and even after fights and stuff. But during the fights, you know, when Eric made a point, it's like I don't even remember him doing anything crazy or anything. I hardly remember him at all in the corners and stuff like that. And, you know, the way it was put from Eric was put in a good way. He said, you know, this guy knows what he's doing in the corner. He's, you know, he's playing the game when the game should be played, and he seems serious when he needs to be serious. With that said, I mean, if he goes in and he's smart and he gives the right game plan, does Danny have a chance to outbox Mathysse and stay away and, you know, utilize his own skills?
He does. Absolutely he does, of course. I'm not taking anything away from Danny Garcia, but what I really think, and what bothers me, is people seem to think Lucas Mathysse is nothing but a power puncher. There's more to him than that. You don't have a resume like his, you know, without being a power puncher. And, you know, his two losses are very disputed losses. You know, he's never been dominated. He has a great chin. He gets better as he goes out. And you talk about a guy with determination and a heart and a will to succeed. You know, that's definitely Lucas Mathysse. And if you look at his last three or four fights, he's getting better every fight. And as far as Angel in the corner, Danny Garcia, to my knowledge anyway, has never really been in big trouble, so we don't know how Angel will react when, not forget him as a trainer, we don't know how he's going to react when his son is really hurt, you know, when in that Judah fight, I think it was, you know, the 11th or 12th round when he got in trouble, and he wasn't in the type of trouble that Lucas Mathysse can put him in, though he was rocked, so, you know, it's yet to be seen. You know, we won't know until fight night what happens. Maybe Angel will be very cool in the corner, you know, if Danny gets hurt, maybe he won't, but point of the matter is, once they're inside the ring, how's Danny going to act when Danny's really hurt? There's another question.
Yeah, and I think that well, Danny did get hurt in the Zab Judah fight, and he. Yeah, I know, and it was just, he shouldn't have gotten hurt, but.
And like I said, it wasn't the type hurt that Lucas Mathysse will give.
No, I agree. Dax, I was going to say Alex. Dax, I appreciate you coming on. We're looking for you on Friday. We got a lot of, on Saturday. We're going to be on for a long time. And we got a great lineup of guests. So hopefully we'll be chatting with you again maybe a little bit tomorrow and on Saturday.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know what? I just wanted to clear one thing up from a conversation we had the last time about the titles, with the WBA and WBC. I don't think we had a chance to speak about that off the air.
We did talk about it.
Canelo has both belts, the WBC and WBA.
And Floyd's got the WBA super junior middleweight.
Right. Remember, Canelo won the WBA when he beat Austin Trout. Austin won the WBA title when it was vacant, when he went against Canelo's brother, Rigoberto.
No, he won that title off of Cotto, right? Oh, no. That's right.
He won it off Rigoberto. Cotto was fighting. Cotto was the challenger in that fight.
Floyd lost the title. Cotto lost that title to Floyd.
Correct.
And then he got elevated, and that's how that's why Canelo ended up with the regular old junior middleweight.
He still got the belts though.
Yes.
Hey, real interesting thing for people to talk about later. You know, Oscar De La Hoya's cousin is making his debut tonight, Diego De La Hoya. You were talking the other day about, you know, how things are going to go inside the head of somebody, you know, with mentally. And how things affect. I wonder how it's going to affect Diego tonight, making his pro debut without Oscar in his corner on a Golden Boy card over at the MGM.
Well, I heard he was going to probably have a drink and a couple of lines of Coke before the fight, you know, and to calm him down. I don't know, but we'll have to wait.
Who knows? Hey, this is a packed weekend of boxing. You know what? To give you the rundown, it'd take another whole show.
I know.
So it's going to be great.
I know, man. And like I said, we'll be looking forward to you again, hopefully a little bit tomorrow, and then definitely Saturday. We're going to have a great time at Miller's Coral Springs Ale House. So I wish you were here. If the weather was nice, you'd be missing something, but... You know, it's like hurricane season or something.
I hear you. So everybody have a great night, and I'll talk to you tomorrow and definitely Saturday. Make sure everybody tune in.
All right, Dax. Take care. That's Dax Khan. You can check him out on Thursdays generally on www.billycboxing.com. I got a couple of emails I want to read real quick before we take a break. Snoop Stock says, Beltran dropped Burns, broke his jaw, fought on his front foot for the majority of the fight. But he, meaning me, thinks the challenger wasn't robbed. Even Jim Watts said he deserved the belt. My point about that fight, and we're talking about the Burns and Beltran fight, was that the close rounds, everybody admitted that the close rounds, there were close rounds. Scotty Krause was on the show yesterday. He said that he gave the close rounds to Beltran, and his scorecard ended up being a one-way scorecard. Think about where the fight was. It was in Burns' hometown. Those close rounds all went to Burns, despite the knockdown and getting beaten up and everything else. That was my only point, you know, that, the close rounds can go either way. You know, that's why we call them close rounds. And, you know, I hate to promote the WBC, but their new scoring system actually eliminates this kind of thing. And if you read about their computerized scoring card, the way it works is if there's a fighter, in this case, that dominates a round, you know, it's you're scoring it by that. So that, you know, if a fighter A dominates fighter B for round one and just about, you know, let's say he drops him and it's a 10-8 round. And then the second round, the fighter B just barely wins and gets the nod. Now, that's a 10-9 round. And then the third round, the fighter A, you know, beats him good but not, you know, doesn't knock him down or nothing. That's 10-9. When you add up the scores, you know, he's ahead by 3 points now. And really, he only won 2 rounds. So, you know, I like the WBC's thing. Thanks for the email, Snoop Stock. My man or lady, I don't know, but one of my favorite handles, Pussy Stroker, says, hey, Bills, and all you guys with the hey, Bills stuff, I love it. He says, do you agree with me that Rosado should stop fighting guys two classes above him? Example, Triple G, Kid Chocolate, both were mismatches. You know what, Pussy? I was thinking that, you know, he was a guy that, you know, does not, you know, even think twice about challenging himself. And that's the kind of fighters that I like. Fighters that, you know, will challenge themselves and go for that. First of all, that Triple G fight, he looked pretty good until it was stopped. And as far as the Kid Chocolate fight goes, you know... I don't know. Was that much of a mismatch? You know, we'll see. We'll see on that one. But thanks for the emails. I got time for another email real quick. Let's see. We got a few of them here. We got coming up in a little bit. We got Ian Grumeza, who's the author of The Gentleman Boxer, which is a great book that you got to put into your collection. Like I told you, you can get yourself a copy by visiting his website, www.iangrumeza.com. That's I-O-N-G-R-U-M-E-Z-A.com. Or visit our website, BillyCBoxing.com. Click one of the banners. Can take you right to Ian's website or to Amazon, where you can buy yourself a copy of the book. But if you want a signed copy, drop me an email, Billy@TalkinBoxing. That's TalkinBoxing.com. And we got a bunch of great prizes to give away for people that call in. When we tell you, we got a lot of guests. Ian Grumeza is coming in, and also Harold Lederman is scheduled to join us in a little bit. So we got a lot of good stuff going on today. My man Devin from Bombay, India, says, you're absolutely right, Billy. See, you know, when you start an email like that, you're going to win every time. He says, if he loses, the weight should not be an excuse for Canelo, and I'll be the first to call it BS if that's what the Canelo camp comes up with afterwards. But you have to admit that if Canelo makes the 152, and I think he should come in at 154 and pay the fine, this is what Devin says. He says he certainly won't be at peak fighting condition. But as you said, the man signed the contract, and I don't want to hear any excuses. He says it's going to be an easy night for Mayweather. Mayweather's probably the best fighter in this generation and a Hall of Famer, but no way is he ever going to be rated as amongst the greatest of all time. Devin, you got to ask Floyd about that because he feels he's already the greatest of all time. He says, unless he follows the Sugar Ray and Duran's path and goes up to the fight the big bad monsters at middleweight, which he won't, which I agree with you, he won't because he doesn't have the balls to. He says his legacy will always have an asterisk that he never fought the best at the right time or outside his comfort zone. I agree with you, Devin, that you agree with me about the weight and everything else. But here's the thing. He is going to always have a problem. And should he lose this fight, I think that so many people, because Mayweather put so much emphasis in the O, I think that, you know, people are going to start to say exactly that. And, you know, I'm starting to get second thoughts about how easy of a night it's going to be for Floyd. I'm seeing some body language from Canelo that clearly gives me some hope that Canelo is going to be doing well. Hey, don't forget, we got a poll. I know you guys are liking the first stream that's up on LDLTV.com, but take a minute, go to the second poll, go to the second stream, which is the Ustream stream, and check out the poll question. Click that, and we'll get you the results of that one tomorrow. And maybe later I'll give you the results of the poll question yesterday, which I just found out what it was, which is pretty entertaining. So I'll get to that in a little bit. One last email. This is from nobody here who happens to be in the chat room. He says, I'm psyched about the fights. He says, I think it's going to be a good night of fights. I'm worried about Garcia and Mathysse, but I love Philly, and I really love Argentine beef, some of the best beef in the world. So I'm just going with Philly. Go Danny. You know, well, if you love the Argentinian beef, man, why wouldn't you go with the other guy? You know, where's the beef? But that's anyway. He says, I know there's no logic in that pick. I'm worried that Canelo's running 800-meter sprints, and his times are horrible. He says 252 is not even good for a girl athlete. Horrible for a world-class athlete. He says, anyway, on to All Access. He says, it seems Canelo wants to end the match in five rounds, so I don't know, but if that's the case, it makes a lot of sense because Canelo has terrible endurance problems. One thing that was very cool is that I didn't know that the WBC was started in Mexico. If that's the case, that's why this championship means so much to Canelo and the belt, if all good marketing for Mexican is all good marketing for Mexicans. He says, I thought it would make things fishy, but I think it makes a lot of sense. Fans deserve something to believe in. I think even if Canelo loses, he's going to be a huge star for Mexico and for the U.S. Mexican fans, just like Chavez. I tell you what, nobody here. He's already a huge star in Mexico. They refer to him as just Canelo. I think there's more fishiness going on with this fight, the more I think of it, than just where the belt, WBC belt originated. Remember, the WBA now has matched it. They are going to be producing their own very special belt. You know, we got $150,000 worth of belts in, that's going to be on the line. So I don't know, man. I may change my pick come tomorrow. I may. You're going to have to tune in tomorrow to find out. But anyway, that takes care of the emails. We're scheduled to have Ian Grumeza come up in a little bit. Just a reminder, this whole week is being brought to us by the TKO Network. Check these guys out. They got the same philosophies as we have here at LDL TV. You can follow them on Twitter at the TKO Network. You can friend them on Facebook at the TKO Network. And you can check out their website at thetkonetwork.com. The show is also being brought to you in part by Sal's Pizzeria in St. Simons Island, Georgia. Sal's going to be ringside with us, or sort of ringside, bar side, at the Miller's Coral Springs Ale House on Saturday night. And we're going to replay Sal's record-breaking fight, which I had the privilege of calling the action ringside with Nate Campbell. So he's going to be here with us on Saturday at the Miller's Coral Springs Ale House, which is located on 1915 North University Drive. Check it out. It's $10. We'll get you in. They got drink specials all night long, including my favorite $5 double well drinks, which is perfect for the scotches you're going to buy me. So come on down there. Find out that where we're going to be. Hang out with us. And we'll have a good time. I'm going to take a short break. When I come back, Ian Grumeza is scheduled to join us. We'll be right back.
Titty Grab, a game of cards, friends, and titties. When you spot a match, grab that titty fast. No foreplay required. Titty grab is full of temptations. Control yourself or you'll pay the price. Get rid of all your cards to win the game. Titty grab. Grabbing a titty has never been this much fun.
LDL TV, streaming live to you the best in amateur USA and Golden Gloves events, professional boxing, live mixed martial arts, major concerts, music, comedy, special red carpet events, professional pool, beach volleyball, car racing, boat racing, live corporate events, and much, much more. All live to you in crystal clear, smooth streaming video. LDL TV, live down the line, the best every time.
My name is Tonton Bisha. You and me, we're watching now, Talking Boxing with Billy T on your favorite TV, LDL TV. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Olden Pontius, former NBA player. You're watching Talking Boxing on LDL TV with my man, Billy C.
Billy C, you don't call anymore. You don't stalk me. I mean, I appreciate the occasional shout out, but I lie in my bed shouting your name out all the time. Nothing. I don't know what happened. We were so close. And everybody likes to watch Billy C talking about boxing.
Boxing. Boxing is more than a sport. Boxing is a lifestyle. A lifestyle to be found on TKONetwork.com. TKO Network delivers free boxing action from around the globe to your computer, tablet, smart TV, and smartphone. TKO Network offers viewers a variety of original programs. TKO Network, the world's ringside seat, coming soon.
What the book is about?
Well, it's about a young fighter, an immigrant. His name is Joe Green. He became professional at age 17, and he scored 24 knockouts in a row. At that time, was quite a performance, and he was a very promising challenger. Except that he lived in Massachusetts. He moved to be a good promoter in New Jersey. His brother Mike, there's always a brother, older brother Mike is with him, and tried to co-promote and co-manage his younger brother Joe, and he has a big conflict with a real promoter, and Joe is very good boxer. He's a bantam, by the way. He's a scrapper, and he keep winning. He fights, you know, two or three categories higher than he is, and in short notice, one week, he fought three times. So he wins, you know, left and right and so on, and he hopes to have a shot to the title, but that cannot be, because Charles Dosseri, his promoter, has another two bantams in his stable, and they, of course, are from local guys, and they have to be pushed forward before Joe. Even Joe is better than they are. And therefore, the book shows how the boxing industry works in the 1920s, when, of course, there are a lot of great names there, from Jack Dempsey to Harry Graham to Mickey Walker to, you name it, everybody was there, Ben Leonard, and it shows how hard it was to become a champion. Yet, there are so many champions, because there are so many fighters at that time. Each single town, and of course, bigger cities, used to have a ring, an arena, a boxing arena, where people came and entertained, and there were boxing matches throughout the week and the weekends, and it was the main attraction. Remember, the soldiers, the American boys came from World War I, and they all learned boxing routines in the army training, and they came home, and they loved boxing, and a lot of new champions are from the boxing, from the army ranks, like Gene Tooney, and he was the Marine, of course. And so Joe is there in New Jersey and beyond with all the greatest, and he shares the same.
We just lost Ian. No, the box just locked up, so we'll recall Ian here in a second. But I guess when you bring the phone system, doesn't matter where you are, it still locks up, and that's exactly what just happened. So we'll get Ian back here in a second. But anyway, while we're getting that, because you're gonna have to reboot that whole machine. So what's gonna happen here? Let me talk a little about the last press conference, the final press conference for the one. You know, Mayweather said some stuff during this press conference yesterday that irked me. The reason is, you know, I understand that every fighter has to have confidence and everything else, but some of the statements that Floyd made yesterday, ironically enough, kind of fit into what we were saying last night, especially with John Scully, that, you know, a fighter has to experience certain things. They can't just say it. John Scully made some interesting points yesterday. He said, you know, I've talked to many fighters that said, I would never quit on my stool. I would never do this, never do that. And then in the heat of battle, they certainly do that. So yesterday, Floyd, for the final quotes, Canelo said a couple of things yesterday. He said he wanted to thank all the people around him. And he just said that he had a great camp. He's prepared. And he promises to be victorious. That's it. And he got off the podium. Floyd stepped up and spoke for a few minutes, not as long as he usually did, but he said enough to irk me, and I'll quote what Floyd said. He says, I've been here before, so I know what it takes. A guy that's 42-0, he hasn't faced 42 Floyd Mayweathers. Floyd Mayweather hasn't faced one Floyd Mayweather either, but that's besides the point. He says because he'd be 0-42, and I think if Floyd Mayweather fought another caliber fighter like himself, he certainly wouldn't be undefeated either. So, you know, that's just another BS line by Team Mayweather. But anyway, he says, I don't worry about who he's faced, even though he just said that he didn't face a good quality opposition. And then his next line is he doesn't worry about it. But obviously he's considered that. He's put that in his memory banks. Floyd says, what any fighter can do good, I can do great. Yeah, okay. You know, every parent tells their kid how great they are. Floyd apparently still believes all of that. Is he a very good fighter? Yes. Is he a great fighter? We don't know. The word great should not be used, at least in my opinion, should not be used with a fighter until after their career is over and we can evaluate their whole body of work. So, it just irks me when he talks like this. I understand that he's got to be positive and I'm okay with that, but I think he goes a little over the top. He says, I'm facing, I was born to be here. He says, whatever fighter can, whatever fighter can do good, he does great. He was born to be here. He's born to be on the level. I'm at the pinnacle of boxing. I am the face of boxing. I'm dedicated to my craft. It took hard work, prayers and dedications, and a good team. He says, this fight will be just another stepping stone. He's just another opponent to me. He knows he's facing Floyd Mayweather. He says, I'm facing just another opponent. I'm dedicated. I'm hungry. Blah, blah, blah. He says, it's going to be the same old thing no matter what the game plan is. If the game plan's to keep pressure, I know how to handle it. If the game plan's to box, can't nobody outbox me. And he says, you have to be able to outmatch me mentally, and I'm the strongest mental fighter in the sport of boxing. And that was said by Floyd Mayweather yesterday in the final press conference. That last sentence, and apparently he went to the Bernard Hopkins School of English because he speaks sort of like Bernard Hopkins. But anyway, listen, I think we got my man Ian back. Ian, do we got you back?
I'm back. Thank
I'm sorry you. About that. We had a phone line issue. Let's try and pick up where we left off. I know you were describing the book, and one thing that I find interesting in that book, well, a couple of things. Number one, back then they didn't take as many care in the records. So his record is as impressive as it is. It took you a lot of research to try and track down, even though they're all recorded in newspaper articles and everything else. It's kind of tough to get them, let's say a box rec or something like that. What's been the struggle with something like that?
Yes, I spend a lot of time in Fall River, which is his hometown in New Bedford. This is in Massachusetts. I went to Bayonne. I went to Jersey City. I spent maybe weeks in the library and the newspapers of those days. And indeed, Joe Green is in all those articles, the the that time boxing had a special place in any newspaper. There was a boxing reporter that went to the ring, and the next day he will give a decision. Remember, in New Jersey, there is no decision state. In other words, if you don't put a guy down to 10 counts, you do not win. It's a draw. So New Jersey was the land of all the boxers, all the good boxers to come and check out their potential, because there's no danger of losing by points, okay? And everything was a draw. However, Joe Green wins by knockout many times, and he's on all newspapers, and he really starting to make an impact in the community and even in New York City, and the promoters took notice of him and so on, except Mike, his older brother, was very anxious to make more money and push him in the big league fights, and his promoter, the Sheikh, didn't want to take that risk, because if Joe would be killed in the ring, that would be the end of it, of him. So after almost half a year, they decided to go back home in Massachusetts, because he bought with his ring money a grocery store, and their parents are sick, they're old, he has a numerous family, the family needed them. So that was the end of Joe Green, very inglorious. He continues to fight there without training, he still wins, and he's great respected in the area. He lived to be 96 years old, and he was always the champ. And it's a book about how to be a winner in the ring and in life. He could not be a champion, but he made enough money to set up his family to a path of prosperity, and he became one of the biggest investor in real estate and so on. What is interesting is that when everybody lost money, all the boxers, all the champions, including Jack Dempsey and Leonard and you name it, because the crowd, market, the depression, 1928-29. So, but Joe was out of the ring before that, so he didn't invest any money. Mike took the money, and he knew what to do with the money. He was smart. So, at the very end, Joe was a winner. He was never hurt in the ring. He was a family man. He lived a long and successful life, and he knew, he had some glory in the ring, and the newspapers articles, which I quote a lot in the book, shows that plentifully.
Well, we're going to definitely have you on several times over the next couple of months, and we'll get into the book. I know Alex Papali and I are going to do some special stuff. It's a great read. Like I tell everybody, get yourself a copy. Visit Ian's website, www.iangrumeza, that's I-O-N-G-R-U-M-E-Z-A.com, or click one of the banners on our website, BillyCBoxing.com. We got a big fight this weekend, Ian, and I know you like to look at the historical aspects of fights because of your book. But
I cannot wait. You know what? I believe that this would be a repetition of, Klitschko, the Russian champion, with Lennox-Lewis. And, when Klitschko is hurt and he has to quit, and Lennox-Lewis won by TKO. But this is the level of this fight. It's probably one of the best fights there will ever be. Unless we'll be over in 20 seconds or something like that. So if you are interested, I believe that Alvarez will win.
You're taking Alvarez? Why do you think Alvarez will win?
He's a better boxer. He is well balanced. He has a hard punch. He has a strong neck. He's just a solid fighter. If only an accident will stop him not to win. He's not how can I say, he's not there to show off anything. He's just there to win and go home. He's that type of fighter that in the 1920s, only Gene Tierney and Leonard, Ben Leonard used to be. Meaning, he's a professional. He also is younger, and he's a good counterpuncher. Any mistakes that Luis is going to make in that in this match, what is his name?
Mayweather.
Alvarez will exploit each single move. I'm very sure. He also is the one. One of those boxers who really works the body, the midsection, which really makes a huge difference in a long fight in the ring. So I believe that Alvarez is going to win, and of course, Lennox Lewis is a great fighter and so on, but he has that kind of bravado there to drop his arms in the middle of the ring and show off his ability to not to be punched, which would be a big mistake in front of Alvarez.
Interesting. I haven't given my official pick yet, but I will tomorrow. But Ian, I appreciate you coming on and talking about the book and giving your predictions. I know we'll get together sometime next week and get you scheduled to come on our normal show, and we'll go in depth with the book and some other stuff. All right.
Anytime. Thank you for having me.
All right, Ian. Take care, man.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
That's Ian Grumeza. Get yourself a copy of his book. Like I said, www.iongrumeza.com for Ian's website, or you can visit our website, BillyCBoxing.com, and click on any of the Gentleman Boxer banners. Can't miss them. They're all throughout the site. Click them. Some of them go to Amazon.com, where you can buy a copy of the book directly, or you can go to Ian's site, or even email me, Billy@TalkinBoxing. That's TalkinBoxing.com, and I'll get you a signed copy. Interesting. My man Ian picked Saul Alvarez. And speaking of Alvarez, I was just commenting before we got before John hung up on John's man in the phones. He hung up on Ian. So before we got him back, I was talking about the comment that Floyd was making. And the last thing I think is one of the most important parts of why I believe that he is just a total BS artist. Now, I'm not taking away any of his talent, so please don't start telling me how great he is. But he's a BS artist, okay? You know how Mike Tyson said the other day, a couple weeks ago, he's been BSing everybody. He was only sober for 6 days and all of this stuff. You know, well, Floyd's been BSing us for a long time. Yes, he's got skills, but just like he said, if Saul Alvarez fought 42 Floyd Mayweathers, he would be 0-42. Well, if Floyd Mayweather fought one or two or three quality fighters, like if he wants to refer to himself as a Floyd Mayweather, he too would have losses. So, I mean, he is basically saying how I feel about him. But I think the biggest statement that he made is how he brags about being the strongest mental fighter. Now, I don't want people to look at that as his intelligence level. I'm not questioning his intelligence level, because all you got to do is match his bank account statements and you can see that the guy's got to have some kind of brain to make that kind of money. So I'm not going to say anything negative about that. But just like we were saying with John Scully yesterday, how can a guy be strong mentally when he hasn't tested himself? Just like John said, it's easy to say, I will never quit, I will never go down, I will never lose, until you experience that. You experience that knockdown, that first time that you lose your legs, you have no control over your legs, you get a good shot and, everything's, you're seeing stars. I don't know if any of you have ever really seen stars, but I have, and it's little dots in front of your eyes, and it makes it very hard to concentrate on anything. Plus, you know, depending upon the knockout, if it was an equilibrium shot or something like that, your legs aren't working. He's never experienced any of that. They've never put him in harm's way in training, and he certainly hasn't put himself in harm's way against a fighter. So we don't know how strong mentally he is. That's one of those question marks I personally have, and that's what I'm looking for in this fight. Nobody here is in the chat room. His last statement right here says Floyd Mayweather can't take a shot from Canelo like that. He can't take the shot, and he won't plan on taking a shot. But what if Canelo connects? That's the whole key of this fight. And speaking of the fight, you know, they were talking about how great this fight card was. And to be honest with you, unless I'm missing a fight, Canelo and Mayweather, that's the main event. The co-main event is Danny Garcia and Lucas Mathysse. And then the third fight is Ishii Smith going against Carlos Molina. You know, those are the three championship fights. Then the undercard is a slew of young fighters. Luis Arias, he's 6-0 with three knockouts. He's going to be taking on Latif Monday in a six-round fight. And, you know, that's in the super middleweight division. That's one fight. Another six-fight veteran, Ronald Gavril, is 6-0 with five knockouts. He is going to be taking on Michigan's Saijay El-Amin, who's 12-4. He used to be Deion Savage. Oh, okay, I remember Deion Savage. I was going to say, I never heard of Amin. That also is a super middleweight bout. That one's scheduled for eight rounds. Also scheduled on the undercard is Chris Pearson. He's 11-0 with eight knockouts. He's going to be taking on Joshua Williams out of Rhode Island, 9-5 with five knockouts. That's in the middleweight division, scheduled for eight rounds. And the first fight of the night is Linnell Bellows, who's 5-0 with a draw, going up against a fighter out of West Virginia who's 3-0. But, you know, fighters from West Virginia, 3-0, that's who knows. So I think that record is going to show us that it's not as good as it looks. And that's also in the super middleweight division. It's a four-round matchup and also a four-round cruiserweight fight between Andrew Tabitti going up against Edward Smith. Edward Smith is 1-0 out of New York, and Tabitti is 1-0 as well. So that's the undercard. It's a slew of very young fighters and three experienced fighters, and that's what you're getting for your $80 or whatever. You're getting three fights that you're going to see on TV. Listen, we're going to take a break here in a minute. When we come back, we're scheduled to have what's his name? My man, Harold Lederman. I know. My man, Harold Letterman's going to be joining us. It's interesting to see what he thinks about this card. I know I talked to him about this a couple of weeks ago. I just want to give you a quick rundown. On Saturday, we got a slew of great guests coming on, former world champion. He's a Billy C. Boxing Hall of Famer, and I think he should be an International Boxing Hall of Famer. Marlon Starling is going to be joining us on Saturday, as well as another Billy C. Boxing Hall of Famer, and Ernie Shavers, one of the hardest punchers in the sport of boxing. He's going to be joining us. Sal Cinicola will be ringside with us. We're scheduled to have Carl King ringside with us, and some other people too. Eric Botcher, the matchmaker, was here on Monday, and we're getting a bunch of other callers coming in. So we're going to have a great time. Plus, we're going to have the phone lines open for you to call and talk to all of us as well. So make sure you mark that one down. We will be at Miller's Ale House on 1915 North University Drive in Coral Springs, Florida. $10 gets you in the door. They got some drink specials like $7 Miller pitchers of beer, $8.95 buckets of Bud, and a $5 double booze drinks, which is my, hey man, $5, you get me a double scotch, and that's great. So looks like we're going to have to take a break here in a minute. And when we come back, we're scheduled to have Harold Lederman. We need a fan in here, but anyway, hey, we're going to take a short break. We'll be right back.
Titty Grab, a game of cards, friends, and titties. When you spot a match, grab that titty fast. No foreplay required. grab is full of temptations. Control yourself or you'll pay the price. Get rid of all your cards to win the game. Titty grab. Grabbing a titty has never been this much fun.
Boxing. Boxing is more than a sport. Boxing is a lifestyle. A lifestyle to be found on TKONetwork.com. TKO Network delivers free boxing action from around the globe to your computer, tablet, smart TV, and smartphone. TKO Network offers viewers a variety of original programs. TKO Network, the world's ringside seat. Coming soon.
But Anthony's an unbelievable guy. His most recent party, he had Dave Diamante, the ring announcer, make pizza when he found out that Dave used to make pizza for a living. Oh. So we went down there, and Dave Diamante cooked two pizzas at Anthony Catanzaro's pizza place. Portobello's on Murray Street. Fabulous pizza.
Well, I tell you, I drove down. I'm down in Florida right now, Harold, and I drove down because I had a couple of stops to make, and one of them, of course, was to see Sal. And they throw a pie in front of me, you know, and I sat there and ate the whole thing like the fat bastard I am, you know. But I really, really,
see.
Yeah.
Where are you in Florida?
South Florida. We're in Coral Springs, right, a little above Fort Lauderdale.
Oh, okay, good. Yeah, we have a place in Pompano Beach.
Oh, that's where I used to go all the time. It's right near Pompano Beach. That's why I like it here. Pompano is where I went for 3 weeks every February for 10 years. So, and we just stopped. I just stopped, and now I'm back. So, anyway, big fight this weekend. Did you hear?
Oh, yeah, sensational. I mean, I'm going to go see the doubleheader, the live show featuring Chris Algieri, and then the Floyd Mayweather fight on the big screen out at the Paramount Theater in Huntington, New York, where Joe DiGuardia puts on, you know, live fights. And he's had 10 shows out in Huntington at the Paramount Theater, and every one of them has been a sellout. And interestingly enough, his big ticket seller is Chris Algieri, who's fighting on Saturday night, and the semifinal is Joshua Clowney, who just signed a contract with Joe DiGuardia, Star Boxing. So it's going to be a big night of boxing. I think it's four live fights plus the four pay-per-view fights.
Well, okay.
It'll be an interesting night.
What's the fourth pay-per-view? I'm only knowing, the only ones that I keep seeing is Alvarez, Mayweather, the Mathysse, Garcia, Molina, and Ishii Smith. What's the fourth one they're going to show?
It's Ashley Theopane against Pablo Cesar Canelo.
Okay, so they're putting that one on the pay-per-view. Theopane, yeah. Canelo is a tough fighter, and Theopane is he's always been one of my favorite fighters, but he's not too exciting. I saw him at I think you saw him at Mohegan Sun when I was there one time. Did you
probably don't remember him.
Yeah, well, he's got a gazillion tattoos. But anyway, let's talk about the main event first. Canelo Alvarez against Floyd Mayweather. How do you see this fight going, Harold?
Well, unless Floyd hurts his hands, because he don't fight very well through pain. But unless he hurts his hands, I like Floyd Mayweather. I think that he's too quick. Canelo, you know, I keep watching the All Access 24/7, whatever you want to call it. I keep watching those shows, and to me, Canelo Alvarez is just too straight up. I mean, you know, he doesn't bomb and weave enough, for my liking. He doesn't move his head enough. He's a straight up guy, and Floyd, you know, Floyd boxes himself standing straight up like that. I mean, the guy just can't stand straight up and outbox Mayweather. You know, unless he lands a power shot, he really hurts Floyd. But I don't know. I just see Floyd outboxing him easily, probably winning about 8 rounds to 4. I like Floyd by unanimous decision, unless he hurts his hands. If he whacks Canelo in the second round and comes back to the corner and says, my hand's broken, forget it. Floyd can lose. But other than that, I just think Floyd is too slick, too quick. You know, he'll start doubling the jab and tripling the jab and throwing combinations. And I don't know. I just can't see Canelo getting out of the way because he's not the busiest guy in the world. He doesn't throw the first punch all the time. And and he certainly doesn't move his head a lot. You know, you got to be busy to be Floyd Mayweather. You know, you got to put a lot of pressure on him, and you got to throw a lot of punches, and that's not Canelo's style. Canelo, you know, more of a one-punch guy, and as I say, doesn't move his head a lot. You know, unless he starts landing power shots, I just like Floyd by decision.
You know, you're right about Canelo standing straight up. I also noticed that he doesn't seem to even throw any punches unless he's standing straight up in front of his opponent, and then he has a tendency.
Well, he's not a busy guy.
No, and he actually has a tendency to lock his knees and kind of lean right in. Like, it looks like an uppercut would really stun him. I don't see a guy like Floyd Mayweather, you know, letting him stand in front of him. That's the whole point.
No, Floyd's not. You know, I think that, you know, Floyd will be moving, will be using angles, and he'll just have box this kid. I mean, I think, you know, he's not the quickest guy in the world, and he's not the busiest guy in the world, and he's very straight up. I mean, he wins because he's got good skills, he hits hard, he overpowers, but I don't think he's going to do that to Floyd. I think he's going to take too many shots. Floyd could stop him on cuts, as a matter of fact, you know, because Floyd throws a lot of punches, he gets off first. You know, so there's a lot of combinations, and he's quick. And Canelo just isn't quick, and I don't think Canelo can handle that speed.
You know, let me ask you a question, something that, I don't know. I don't know if I'm just trying to look at this but in a different way. But, I see a lot of money that's been spent on it. I'll just come right out and say it. Do you see Floyd Mayweather possibly getting...
And he's very close to my daughter. I worked with Craig Metcalf in Buenos Aires. I just can't remember if he worked the Sergio Martinez fight or if he worked the semifinal with, you know, Anthony DiCarri and Luis Carlos Abreu. But he was in one of the two, you know. So because I know I worked with him. I spent time with him down in Buenos Aires on that show. He's an excellent official. He really is. I mean, without question, he's the best judge in Canada. And, so I have nothing against Craig Metcalf. I would let him work any day for me, you know, if I were a commissioner. And certainly Moretti, if you're going to use a Nevada judge, I'd pick Moretti first. But C.J. Ross, I sort of was against C.J. Ross working Manny Pacquiao, Timothy Bradley. And I said it before the fight started, you know. But, hey, they did what they did, and they got what they got, you know. So, I mean, she's a very nice person, nice woman. I like her a lot. She's a good friend of mine, but... Not in this kind of situation where it's such a huge fight. I just would have brought in a judge from the outside, and you know, I would have got somebody really, really good that I knew was really, really good.
Yeah, no, listen, I'm glad you clarified with Metcalf, because I wasn't familiar with Metcalf at all, and I was like,
Craig is excellent. Yeah. I mean, he's as good as you get, you'll see.
Oh, good.
He always does an outstanding job. Yeah, so he's a young guy, very good judge, extremely good.
Good, because I was concerned, you know, I got to be honest, you know, I wouldn't mind it, let me just put it that way, if Floyd lost the fight, but I don't want to see him get robbed. I'd want to see him lose legitimately, you know, and I don't want to see a robbery, because I look at it this way, Harold. The rematch, should Floyd lose, which is unlikely, but should he lose, the money that would be made in the second fight, and I'm not just talking about Floyd and Canelo's purses, I'm talking about everyone else involved, would be through the roof. I mean, that's the driving force to my thought process of an unfair decision. That's where I'm coming from with that. Did we lose you, Harold? We lost Harold. We're going to try and get Harold back. We're going to we lost him here on the phone system, which has been known to do that. So we'll try and get him back. But I'm glad that Harold clarified that for me about Craig Metcalf. I honestly didn't know of Craig Metcalf, and he feels very comfortable with him. So that's good. But he echoes my feelings about Dave Moretti and C.J. Ross, both well, Moretti, extremely good, very experienced referee. He has had some you know, negative fights, but for the most part, he's solid. But C.J. Ross has not been too solid at all. So we'll get Howard's Harold's thoughts as soon as we get him back on. We're gonna have to wait a minute here. But an interesting statement today. I read from Steven Espinosa. Now, this was in USA Today, which, you know, I got to give credit to Floyd Mayweather and Saul Alvarez for getting in the mainstream of media for this fight. And Steven Espinosa, who's now the sports director for Showtime, he made an interesting comment. He said that boxing got it right with this matchup. He says that the Mayweather-Pacquiao fight that never happened, this was a good fight to make. He says for the Mexican-American fan base, the Hispanic fan has a hole in the as a hole in the U.S. is bigger than the Super Bowl, he said. He said this is a mega event of the likes we haven't seen in over 20 years. He says you got to go back 20 years to Julio Cesar Chavez or Oscar De La Hoya's both of their biggest fights. And if Alvarez pulls the upset, he says then Canelo becomes the Beatles and Tom Brady rolled into one. You know, this is an amazing analogy that he made because I think that if Saul Alvarez does win, it will be one of the greatest upsets in the sport of boxing. But, you know, I really think that the money thing has something to really consider. At least I'm really considering it here one day before I give my final pick on the fight. And some of the stuff that has been going around, comments and this and that, and I had asked Dax earlier that, you know, I see Floyd trying to rile up Saul Alvarez, and it's not working. You know, I saw some stills today from yesterday's final press conference. You know, Floyd trying to look as mean and as bad as he can, and Saul Alvarez smiling and laughing and looking in the crowd and really just, you know, totally let Floyd try and, you know, impress himself, which clearly he does. But he's not impressing Saul Alvarez. And, you know, it reverts, my thought reverts back to what I was saying a couple weeks ago about bullies and how you beat up a bully. You know, you punch him in his face. You know, you don't let the bully scare you. You don't let him intimidate you. And this is what I think Alvarez is doing with Floyd. And we'll have to wait and see if it's all just, you know, just another opponent, like Floyd says. You know, Alvarez, just another opponent. You know, we'll have to wait and see about that. I think we got Harold back again. Harold, do we got you on the line?
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm sorry about that. For some reason, we lost you there. But just to close out, yeah, I'm glad you straightened me out on Craig Metcalf because I was concerned about that. On the co-main event, a lot of people are looking forward to this fight, and many believe that it's going to be the fight of the night. Lucas Mathysse against Danny Garcia, both quality fighters. How do you see this one going?
Well, you know, I'd say that. Mathysse, it has to be the favorite.
Mathysse?
Hello?
Yeah, Mathysse?
Yeah, he has to be the favorite. Most people you talk to love Mathysse.
Yeah, no,
personally, I like Danny Garcia.
Now let me ask you something. A lot of people are not giving Danny Garcia, because of his last two fights, he hasn't shown really what he's about, and he's a really good boxer. He had a decorated amateur career, and on his way up, he was always on the big fights, on the undercards, on the big fights, and he can box very well. It's just that the last couple of fights, he's been kind of in brawls, and I think people are looking at him as a brawler going up against another brawler, and Lucas Mathysse, obviously, he's got some pop. Do you think that's why people aren't giving him much of a chance? That's Danny?
I think that all great fighters train to the level of the opposition. And I think that, you know, that was true in the Danny Garcia fights. But this one, I think he's going to look sensational.
You think, you know, Angel Garcia, his pops, has been kind of vocal in the press conferences, not only for this fight, but for some previous fights. But John Scully made a great point. Eric Boccia, the matchmaker, made a great point the other night, and he's told us, he says, you know, I don't know him personally, but, you know, he seems to do a really good job in the corner. And I think that that's going to be the key in this fight. You know, as long as Angel doesn't get riled up and, you know, get too tough for his son, so to speak, you know, this fight could very well be in Angel Garcia's hands, driving Danny. How do you see them? What do you think their game plan is going to be?
Well, I think they got a very good relationship. I mean, definitely the game plan is not to get hit. I mean, you know, Lucas Mathysse is a pure puncher, and if you're not careful, he's going to knock you out. That's all there is to it. So the idea is don't get hit on his jaw and outbox him.
You know, you're going to be going to the Paramount down in Long Island. Chris Algieri, you mentioned him. He does very well. Now, wasn't he training in Vegas recently? Doesn't he come out to Vegas to train, and then he's been going back to Huntington to fight?
To the best of my knowledge, he's been training with Robert Garcia in Oxnard, California, you know, with Brandon Rios and those guys.
That's right.
And that's a heck of a gym. I mean, he's got a lot of good fighters out there. So, you know, he's done a lot of good for Chris Algieri.
Yeah, no, you're right. I don't know why I said Vegas, but yeah, I do know that he was did go in that camp. So will Robert Garcia be in his corner for the fight on Saturday?
I don't know. It's hard to predict. He's not fighting a real tough guy. He's fighting somebody from Nicaragua with a very average record. So I don't think that it's going to be a very, very tough fight. Chris Algieri is 17-0 with 7 knockouts. So I'm not so sure Robert Garcia is going to come east if he's got a fighter on the Mayweather show.
Now, also, Joshua Clardy makes his return. I'm glad about that. I've always liked Joshua Clardy. I think he got a raw deal in the Pacquiao fight. A lot of people, just wrote him off after that. And after all, he was fighting Manny Pacquiao. What's your thoughts on Joshua?
Well, I mean, if he comes to fight, he's okay. He didn't show up for the Pacquiao fight. I mean, my goodness, you talk about a guy that didn't try. He just soundly beaten by Pacquiao in Dallas. And, you know, he could have put on a much better performance than he did. He spent just about all 12 rounds covering up. And, you know, so a lot of people paid big money to see that fight. They really didn't get a good fight at all. So, you know, he's got to overcome the stigma of that fight and put on a good performance. And he's moving up to middleweight. He signed with a real good promoter in Joe DiGuardia. So let's see where he goes from here. I hope he looks good Saturday night.
Yeah, well, you fill me in, brother. Let me know what you think. So what's going
okay.
on? What's going on with you, man? What's happening now? When are we going to see you again on TV?
Okay, well, I'm working. Actually, I've got 4 fights in 4 weeks. September 28th, we're back with Julio Cesar Chavez and Brian Vera. I'll be at the Montreal portion of that show. That's Tavoris Cloud against Donna Stevenson in Montreal. You know, it's a split-site show. So I'll be in Montreal with Tavoris Cloud. 1 week later, on October the 5th, I'll be in Orlando, Florida with Miguel Cotto when he takes on the very tough Devin Rodriguez. That should be an interesting fight. Week after that, we'll be out in Vegas for Juan Manuel Marquez and Timothy Bradley. And, you know, Bradley's got a real good chance to fight Mayweather if he can beat Juan Manuel Marquez. I mean, you know, it will be a very interesting fight. You know, two undefeated welterweights. So we'll see where we go with that one. And then on October the 19th, we go to Denver for the unbelievably great one-fight show with Ruslan Provodnikov and you know, Mike Alvarado coming back to Denver to appear on HBO. And, you know, I like that show. No preliminaries. We go right to the main event, and that's going to be a brawl. I mean, it's absolute war written all over it. We also have the great fight that Provodnikov gave Timothy Bradley. He's going to do the same thing in Denver with Alvarado. So I'm looking forward to a sensational night of boxing on October the 19th.
You know, what do you get all the action-packed bouts, brother? Every one of those are going to be action-packed. You know, you're not going to have to worry about anybody.
So.
Yeah, no, that's
I think so. I think it's 4 good shows.
Yeah, no, that's.
I really look forward to that October the 19th show. You know, no preliminary fight to watch. We just go right to the main event. You know, it should be sensational.
Yeah, but I know you. You'll be watching every fight on that card. You know, you may not be on TV for all of it.
Sure. Hey, come on, listen, you never know. We might see a little bit of Stevie Jackson back in the ring. Who knows?
Hey, listen, you know, you mentioned Stevie Johnson's going to be back in the ring on that fight?
No, you never know.
You never know. You know, you mentioned the old saying, never say never. But you mentioned Timothy Bradley. Should Timothy Bradley get by and win the fight, that you might see Floyd and Timothy. You think that they could get past the whole Mayweather Bob Arum thing to make that fight happen?
I have no idea, but there's a distinct possibility. If Floyd looks great and Timothy Bradley looks great with one and all watches, don't you think people will want to see Timothy Bradley than Mayweather? I mean, Timothy Bradley, he may not have beat Pacquiao, but he got the decision, you know. So, you know, he's a guy that's still undefeated. Now, if he looks good this pay-per-view show against Juan Manuel Marquez, and Floyd looks good, I mean, you know, who else would people be screaming for? You know, unless either Danny Garcia or Mathysse looks great, and people start screaming for Danny Garcia against Mayweather and Mathysse against Mayweather. But I think that Timothy Bradley becomes a very, very logical opponent for Floyd Mayweather. So, you know, we'll see. I mean, I don't know how his contract, you know, that six-fight contract that he's got with Showtime, I don't know how that reads, you know, whether he's got the outs or whether Bradley would have to go to Showtime. But I really don't know, you know, the politics of the deal. But in any case, it certainly would be a very, very interesting fight if they do look good, you know, in their next fights.
Yeah, I agree with you, and I hope that does happen. You know, the only problem is, and the thing that bothers me the most is that, you know, Floyd doesn't take any chances. He doesn't like to fight outside of his comfort zone. And you mentioned the winner of the Garcia and Mathysse fight, which I think is a good one to have as well. But it would impress me more if Floyd, you know, went down in a weight, you know, to fight him at 140 and not force him to come up in weight. You know, like he's always forcing fighters to come to his comfort zone. You know what I mean? I'd like to see him, you know, do it outside the box just once. Just show us that he can, you know, do it, you know, go maybe have a little trouble making weight or fight a bigger guy. Uh-huh. What's your thoughts on that?
Well, I mean, I'd like to see Floyd fight Timothy Bradley anyway, whether it's 40 or 47, I'd be happy with the fight.
Not Timothy Bradley.
I think it'd be a good fight either way.
No. I meant the winner of Mathysse and...
Mathysse and Garcia.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, there's no question. I mean, you know, Danny Garcia certainly would be very, very comfortable at 140. There's no doubt about it, you know. So, sure, I'd like to see Floyd fight the winner of Garcia and Mathysse at 140 pounds, no doubt, you know.
Yeah, no, I hope so.
I mean, it has to be an interesting fight, and you're right. You know, let's fight it at a weight where both guys are comfortable, and certainly Danny Garcia and Mathysse are probably more comfortable at 140 these days.
Well, either way, I hope it's an exciting fight, and Harold, I appreciate you taking some time with us tonight, and I hope to see you soon, man.
Oh, I love seeing you, Billy. See, I always love being on with you, love seeing you. You do a great job, and it's just an honor to be with you.
Well, listen, man, with all those accolades, we're going to have you back on as soon as you got time. You know, flattery will get you everywhere, Harold. You know that. So I appreciate
Billy,
it, and I hope to have you back
Billy,
on
soon. You can call me anytime, that's for sure.
All right, man. I'm going to take you up on it.
There you go. Talk to you soon.
All right, have a good time this weekend, brother.
Bye now.
All right, take care. That's Harold Lederman, HBO's Harold Lederman. As you heard, he's going to be real busy over the next few weeks, and he's going to be catching a fight in Huntington, Long Island at the Paramount Theater. Joe DiGuardia and Star Boxing is having a big event there that includes the pay-per-view broadcast. Hey, listen, I'm going to take a short break. When I come back, we're opening up the phone lines, 845-228-8710, for you to call in. You'll win a prize. I told you we got over $1,500. We added it up last night, over $1,500 in prizes to give away. We've just scratched the surface, so you guys got to call in, 845-228-8710. And for anybody that's going to be in the South Florida area, make sure you stop by and see us live on Saturday. We're going to be at Miller's Ale House which is located on 1915 North University Drive in Coral Springs, Florida. Check them out. If you want to call them, give them a shout, 954-825-0574. Ask for my man Kenny or Tony. Tell him Billy C sent you. And they got a $10 to get your butt in the door to watch the fight and a bunch of drink specials that you will not go wrong with. Make sure you're there. Ask for us and come on and hang out with us. Hey, listen, I'm going to take a short break. When I come back, the phone lines are going to be open. Don't be scared. Call in. We'll be right back.
Titty Grab, a game of cards, friends, and titties. When you spot a match, grab that titty fast. No foreplay required. Titty Grab is full of temptations. Control yourself or you'll pay the price. Get rid of all your cards to win the game. Titty Grab. Grabbing a titty has never been this much fun.
Boxing. Boxing is more than a sport. Boxing is a lifestyle. A lifestyle to be found on TKONetwork.com. TKO Network delivers free boxing action from around the globe to your computer, tablet, smart TV, and smartphone. TKO Network offers viewers a variety of original programs. TKO Network, the world's ringside seat, coming soon.
You can follow them on Facebook, friend them at the TKO Network, and also make sure you follow them on Twitter, and that's at the TKO Network. This show is also being brought to you in part by Sal's Pizzeria, Sal Cinecola, and his record-breaking fight over 25 years, 63 or 69 days or something like that, broke the record. He will be with us on Saturday night when we broadcast live from Miller's Ale House in Coral Springs. Also, this show is being brought to you in part by Ian Grumeza's new book, which is called The Gentleman Boxer. You got to get yourself a copy of that. It's a great read. Visit his website, www.iongrumeza, Ian Grumeza. .com or our site, BillyCBoxing.com, for a copy of that. And, of course, the Titty Grab game. Check them out, www.tittygrab.com. The phone lines are open. If you want to win a prize, all you got to do is call in and talk about something that may be boxing. But 845-228-8710. We got the phone guy is handling our phone, so hopefully he won't hang up on you like I hang up on you when you call. So maybe it's all relative. But Harold Lederman, I'm glad he pointed out to me about Craig Metcalf. I had no idea about this guy. I don't recall seeing his name anywhere, and I was definitely concerned with the judges for this fight. I have no comment really about Kenny Bayless. I think that he'll do a fine job. No reservations about him. Dave Moretti, not a bad referee. CJ Ross, I echo Harold Letterman's thoughts on her. She has no business doing this fight, but whatever. I can't help but think that this fight is going to be there's going to be some controversy around. I can't get it out of my mind. You know, I know we were kidding about it yesterday with Scott, and you know, I've talked about it off the air with several people. Dax and I talked about it. It just won't surprise me if something crazy happens, you know, to force a rematch. What I don't want is all the excuses. I know the excuses are going to start coming from both sides, And I think that regardless of the situation, unless it's just a blatant robbery, we can't have excuses for this fight. I mean, no weight excuses, no poor judging excuses, unless it was poor judging, no referee excuses, no excuses. I mean, we really can't, but, anyway, Oh, we got a caller on the line. This is Billy C. What's your name? Where are you calling from?
It's nobody here. I'm calling from New York.
Nobody here? I thought we had somebody on the phone, man. No. What's up, brother? What's going on?
Not much. Just listening to your show like I usually do. Very excited about the fights, I got to tell you.
Well, what's your thoughts? How do you think it's going to go?
I think the way, from watching All Access and everything else, I really think that, Canelo was going to try to surprise Mayweather. He was practicing some duck techniques, and I think that Mayweather, since he's a peddling fighter, I think he's susceptible to maybe a jump hook. I don't know that Canelo could pull something like that off, but I think he might try. And I think it's going to be a hard 4 to 5 rounds for Mayweather. You know, if he can make it through the 4 to 5 rounds, he could win the fight.
I saw a clip today, and it was basically a reporter telling Floyd what Canelo told him his game plan was. And he kind of echoed what I was saying for the last couple of weeks. Obviously, you know about the comments that Roberto Duran made. And I agree with Roberto Duran. I think that is the correct game plan to beat Floyd. And Canelo was starting to tell this reporter that he was going to fight like that. And then the reporter said it to Mayweather. And Mayweather's like, well, he can't do anything to beat me or anything. My question to you is, do you think it was smart for Canelo to really expose that game plan? Or do you think it was just assumed that, we all, like when somebody fights a Klitschko, they say the same thing. Oh, you got to get underneath the jab and win. Just nobody's been able to do it.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think that would surprise Mayweather whatsoever. I mean, I don't think it matters whether or not the reporter tells him whatever, because you don't know what's going to happen at fight night. You don't know what's going to happen if Floyd actually connects a straight right or whatever kind of punch, and maybe rattles Canelo a little bit. You don't know what's going to happen. So I don't know if that matters so much.
If you're in upstate New York and you.
I wouldn't worry so much about, Floyd's defense so much. I would try to do things that Floyd would not be aware of, if I could. And that would be it. That's all you could really do, because I don't think Canelo is smart enough as a boxer to really defeat Floyd that way. He has to do some type of brawling technique to win.
Let me ask you question. Do you follow other sports?
Of course, yeah.
All right. Well, the old saying, we're gonna line up in football. We're gonna line up. We're gonna run the ball. We're not gonna hide anything. We're gonna run at you. Now you just got to try and stop us, right? The Green Bay Packers.
Yeah, in the mouth football.
Right. Punch him in the face. Football. Green Bay Packers. Their famous play is sweep right, sweep left. And you got to stop them. That approach to Floyd Mayweather. Somebody that says, listen, I don't care. Like what I was asking you the question, Saul Alvarez goes in there and says, hey, I'm going to come at you. I'm going to hit you in your body. I'm going to hit you as hard as I can, try and weather the storm. Do you think that approach is smart for a guy like Canelo? Young, aggressive fighter?
I don't think he has any choice. I think if he really wants to win, he has to recognize that he's not as experienced as boxer as Cotto. He's not experienced as even Guerrero. I mean, he has very little world champion experience or real championship experience, so he has to play to his strengths, like every boxer does. He's good at combinations. He throws a 5-hit combination very fast. Could surprise Floyd a little bit, maybe hurt him. And he has to just try to do what he can. It's picking his shots. I mean, I think he could brawl him like Duran did. He could also try to force Floyd Mayweather to exchange. That's another thing he can do by actually running away from Floyd. If he can keep that up, I think he's going to keep that up for a few rounds. But he could do that for a couple of rounds and then make Floyd actually have to chase him. That's something he could try to do too.
What do you think about my fear of Floyd not getting a fair shake with the judges and all about the money for a rematch? I'm really hung up on this, and I'm even confused at my pick all of a sudden. I've been so confident about Floyd for months now, and I'm really getting second thoughts. What do you think?
I think it's a valid concern, considering you have one judge that's new, essentially. I think Floyd also thinks this, too. I think that's why he's talking about a knockout. And he could probably do it, since he's going to have a little extra padding on his gloves. He could go for it. I don't know if he can do it, but he can maybe go for it because his hands will have a little bit more padding. I think it's a worry for Floyd, definitely, because Canelo is a very, very big star in Mexico. He's a very big star in general. And in a close fight, it could go Canelo's way.
Yeah. You know, it's Canelo has nothing to lose in this fight. He's making the biggest payday of his life. Win or lose, as long as he shows a good performance, he's going to still have his fan base. Floyd's got a lot more on the line because I think a lot of people, if Floyd should lose this fight, I think it's going to hurt him big time. I think a lot of people are going to abandon him. I think a lot of people are going to say, I told you so, including myself, you know, and I think he's got a lot to lose. And I give him credit because obviously he knows that as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think he definitely has a lot to lose. I mean, he has his O to lose, but he has a lot of money to make because Canelo's only getting a flat fee, according to Floyd. So, you know, Floyd could actually make like $100 million this day. So, you know, that's if losing is making $100 million, it's not the worst loss. And considering that all those fighters are fighting on this card, I mean, I don't know. It's kind of a... It would be bittersweet because he lost his O, but you know it's not the end of the world for him.
I agree with you there. Well, listen, I appreciate you calling me and email me your mailing address. I'll send you a couple of options for some prizes, and we'll go from there. All right.
Sounds really good, Billy.
All right, brother. Thanks for the call. Nobody here. He's in the chat room. The phone line is still open. We probably got time for another caller. 845-228-8710. 845-228-8710. You know, I guess I don't think because I got another caller on the line. This is Billy C. What's your name? Where are you calling from?
Hey, Billy, this is Al. Give me another call. I just wanted to piggyback on what you guys were talking about from the previous caller. I just saw another clip with... Floyd Sr. talking about that he would be going to the body against Canelo. I just wanted to pick your brain. I mean, if Canelo doesn't normally fight all 3 minutes of a round, how is he going to be able to sustain that against one of the most elusive fighters? I mean, he's never really fought. I mean, just looking at his last three fights, I mean, the guy, he only fights probably a minute and a half of each fight. So how is he going to be able to sustain coming at a guy who's as elusive as Floyd is over 12 rounds? I mean, I just don't see that happening. I think it would be very difficult for judges to screw Floyd out of this fight. I mean, unless Canelo is really landing hard shots, which, you know, we don't normally see people land, you know, two clean shots. You know, maybe a one shot, we've seen people land those clean shots, you know, one clean shot against Floyd, but twos and threes, you don't normally see that. And again, like a guy who's as flat-footed, slow feet as Canelo is, I think it would be difficult for the judges to even try to steal a fight of that magnitude. What are your thoughts?
Well, to answer your question about Saul Alvarez not fighting the full 3 minutes of a round and Floyd being so elusive, Floyd's not really fighting all of the round either, you know, so... I think that's kind of a wash. I think it boils down to the second thought that you said, the second comment, about the type of punches that Saul could land if he lands them or not. That's where the screwing could take place, where you and I could be watching this fight and we see Canelo being the aggressor and throwing punches, you know, just throwing punches but not necessarily landing them flush because of Floyd's expert defense. You know, maybe he's getting grazed, maybe he's slightly moving enough where Alvarez is not connecting, but because he's aggressive, now it's in the judge's hand, and that old word subjectivity comes into play. That's where I think that the robbery could take place. You know, if Floyd is battering him and hitting him at will, and we got what I thought was going to happen originally, where Saul is chasing him around and just getting hit and frustrated, then you're right. There's no way that they can rip him off. But if Floyd is, you know, picking his counter shots and Alvarez is aggressive and winging punches, similar to the Cotto fight, you know, I start thinking about that Cotto fight. And as many punches as Cotto threw that did not land flush, is it going to be a different result if the same punches are thrown and not landed from Alvarez? That's where I think the screwing would take place, if it takes place. This is just me playing devil's advocate.
Yeah, I mean, but do you think, I mean, because Canelo has some of the most slowest feet I think since Floyd has fought Carlos Baldomir.
Yeah.
He's had the slowest speed since Carlos Baldomir, and I just don't see Canelo catching up to Floyd. I mean, he has fast hands. Don't get me wrong; his hands are pretty decent, but his feet. I mean, he's very flat footed. And I was looking at a couple fights. You know, like I said, I saw the Baldomir fight. I mean, even Ricky Hatton had pretty good feet because he was able to pinpoint and get Floyd to the ropes. But I mean, Canelo, if he wants to try to take the strategy of like walking Floyd down, I think that's to his own peril, because I mean, I just don't see how a guy who is so as flat-footed as he being able to sustain that type of fight. I mean, it's a very good strategy if he can pull the Cotto blueprint off, if he can pull the Oscar De La Hoya blueprint off, but he doesn't have quicker feet than Oscar at 35, and he doesn't have quicker feet than Ricky Hatton at 31 or 32 or whatever his age was. So I just don't see him being able to pull that off. I think what he probably will do is try to box Floyd from that standpoint and land a harder shot and hopefully steal some rounds by landing a harder shot. But to actually walk Floyd down, I don't see him being able to accomplish that. And for that matter, when's the last boxer we've seen Canelo walk down? He doesn't normally do that. I mean, he did that against Jose Cito Lopez, who was a natural junior welterweight, but I mean, against guys who are at the weight, he doesn't do that. So I mean, those are my thoughts, and I just wanted to pick your brain on that.
No, you make great points, and I agree. You know, Alvarez is flat-footed. To make things even harder for him, he has a tendency to have to lock his feet in place before he even throws his punches, which is, you know, Floyd's. I think that's why Floyd said yes to fight him. To be honest, I think he saw the same thing I saw with Canelo Alvarez and footage. I just got this weird feeling. I had the same feeling when with the Pacquiao and De La Hoya fight. I mean, it's just nobody is real. I mean, I know the stats. A lot of Hispanic and Mexican fans are picking Saul Alvarez they're betting with their heart, but so I'm not looking at the percentages and all of that, but I'm starting to wonder, that's all, man. But anyway, listen.
Hey, I got one last comment before I hang up. I heard you earlier talking about, you know, Floyd perhaps moving up. One of the things that I learned when I did a little amateur boxing is that a good big man always beats a good little man. And I think Floyd understands that, which is why he won't move up to middleweight and fight some of the bigger guys, because he knows he's a smaller guy. And, you know, I'll hang up and let's hear what you have to comment about that.
Well, don't forget to email me, because you never emailed me. And I wanted to send you.
Yeah, I forgot to email you.
Yeah, drop me an email so I can give you some choices on prizes, brother. You called twice, so I'll give you the choice on the better quality prizes. I'll give the crappy prizes to the people that only call once.
All right, brother.
All right, thanks for calling, Al. Take care, Al from Tampa. My comments on that. What was the main question of that anyway? Oh, I never said that Floyd would have to move up. What I said, and I agree, I think Floyd is at his final destination. That sounds like my navigation system in my car. But I think he's at his final destination in weight. I think he will fight only at welter and catch weight or maybe max 154. But what I meant was I think great fighters and all-time great fighters, special fighters, do special things. Floyd has shown us that he's got immense talent. He's done special things against ordinary opposition. I want Floyd to do something exceptional. If that means step up and fight a bigger guy to show us his skill, then so be it. Or I even left room for him to move down in weight and fight the winner of Mathysse and Garcia. Just something that just isn't all about Floyd. Just think about this fight. Floyd, and I said this yesterday, Floyd is fighting at home. He's fighting in Vegas. He doesn't have to leave anything. He eats the same food, breathes the same air that he does every day. That's number one. Number two, he's fighting in his favorite venue. He fights in a venue that he wants to fight in. That's his venue. Number three, he fights at the weight that he wanted. He picked the weight. He picked the money. He picked the divvy up of everything. He picked the corner that he wants. You know, everything is in his favor. Everything. You know, just one time, I'd like to see it even an even playing field, or have him flip a coin or draw straws, whatever the case is, where something is not perfect for Floyd. Saul Alvarez, in this case, you know, he's got to lose a couple of extra pounds. He's fighting an elusive guy, all of these things. Again, Floyd does nothing special. And that's my hang up with Floyd Mayweather. Does he have skill? Yes. Has he fought the best available? He could arguably be fighting the best available Saturday night. I mean, I can't criticize him for, you know, ducking anybody, because at this point, what's available to him right now, he's not ducking anybody. But up until this fight, there were a lot of fights that he ducked. So should he lose, should he get stopped or something crazy or get robbed on the scorecards, he will never be the same. He says that he's got the best mental approach in the sport of boxing, maybe for training, maybe for historical. But the bottom line is he's never been tested, and to say it is a lot different than to live through it. This is Billy C. Who do we got on the line? What's your name? Where are you calling from?
Billy C. and your mighty mustache. How you been?
Oh, Dawn. Dawn, how are you doing? I thought you were going to be here. I thought you were going to join us.
Well, sometimes I do cameos, and sometimes I just stalk you via telephone.
Oh, are you going to be there Saturday night?
I'm going to try my best. It's not looking great, but you never know what's going to happen, Billy.
Well, from what I hear, you know, it's going to, your perfect environment. There's going to be alcohol around. We're going to have some fun. You get to be on TV a little bit, and we'll hand you a mic. You'll have some fun, man.
Are you under the impression that I drink adult beverages?
I like to. I figured that you were a little like me. You know, I just figured we were in a bar. You know, maybe you would have a drink or two or five or seven or whatever.
Hey, if somebody else is buying, I will not stop drinking. That's the rule.
That's funny. That's my rule, too. But
well, then who's going to buy?
I don't know, but there's a special for them when they do decide to buy, because when they go there, they can get doubles for $5 a piece. So that sounds like a fun night for me anyway.
And how many hours of drinking will be going on? You'll be there from what, 8 to midnight?
8 to at least, well, we'll be on air from 8 until 1:30 in the morning. So, you know, and you would have to get there a little early with us and set up and all of that stuff. So, I think you would do pretty well.
I think I do pretty well everywhere, Billy. I wish right now, because I do have my computer on, I can see you visually. I wish there was like a scratch and sniff just so I could get a whiff of that mustache.
Well, after a few scotches, you could get the whiff pretty far away, trust me.
So you have to be drunk for me to get a little scratch and sniff.
I can't. What do I do? Stuff it. Yeah, I'll stuff it in. I just stuffed it in the mic for you. I don't know if you. Yeah, there's the end of this headset. John's mad at me now, but definitely, man, definitely. You should definitely swing by. John said you might, so hopefully we'll see you.
Yep, I was actually going to drive out to your neck of the woods there today and just walk in the studio and see if you guys had a seat for me, but the day slipped away.
We have one. It says Dawn on it right here. It's right, the green one, like the money one.
Well, I see my liquid asset signs to the right of you. Is that bar still having liquor on it, or is it empty?
No, it's all empty.
It's empty. They didn't give me anything. They've given me water here. They've tortured me here in this studio. I have lights shining on me. I'm losing hair. I'm getting a tan. Just, you know, it's crazy. John just moved it in the shot for you. You see, that's your stuff over there. I can't hear her. I'm losing her.
We lost her.
We just lost her. Well, that was Dawn, and hopefully we will see her on Saturday. We just lost her. We got John Muscunas. Just, you know, we're going to call him the Tornado JJ.
He's not doing anything.
Everything he touches is he's hanging up on people, freezing commercials. anyway, hey, listen, make sure if you're in the South Florida area that you stop by Miller's Ale House on Saturday. That's where we're going to be. That's where we're going to be camped out. We're going to be live from 8 p.m. through the wee hours of the morning, at least 1:30. Out loud, we will be giving you our round-by-round scores. Myself, Carl King is scheduled to be part of our panel, Sal Senecola, and also Eric Botcher will all be part of our panel. So we're looking forward to that. We got several guests that are going to be in-house with us. Hopefully, my girl Dawn will be showing up. If not, we also got a bunch of people calling in on the phone, like Marlon Starling and Ernie Shavers and several other people that I can't recall right now. But that's all that's happening. Before we pack it in tonight, I just want to give a special thanks to the TKO Network. Check them out on their website, www.tkonetwork.com. And also follow them on Twitter at the TKO Network, or befriend them on Facebook, the TKO Network. The show was also brought to you in part by Sal's Pizzeria in St. Simons Island, Georgia. Trust me, top three pizza I ever had in my life, and I would travel all the way to Georgia just to get it, even though I wanted to stop off in Virginia, but that didn't work out for me. But I stopped off in Georgia, and yes, I sat and ate a whole pie, and it was well worth it. Show's also being brought in part by my man Ian Grumeza and his great book, The Gentleman Boxer, the story of Joe Grimm, and some other fighters of the 20s. I highly recommend it to be added to your collection. You can get it by visiting our website, www.BillyCBoxing.com. Click one of the banners. And, of course, JJ's favorite game of all time, the titty grab game. If you like titties, like in his rolling, because I know he loves to grab a titty every now and then too. So, but anyway, don't forget Miller's Ale House, 1915 North University Drive. $10 gets you in the door. Drink specials all night live, all night long. We're going to be there live. We hope to see you. We will be broadcasting right here tomorrow at LDL Studio. I will give you my official picks. I'll break down the fights. All that happy stuff. We got guests lined up for tomorrow. I think Alex is going to be back on, and Scotty's going to stop by. Dax will stop by. And I think we got some other people, too. So make sure you tune in tomorrow. Same bat time, same bat channel. Till then, ciao, baby.